So, you were just talking about scaling blockchain. I'm going to talk about a very different topic. How do we scale human life? How can we live longer on longer health span? So what does that have to do with crypto? So one of the interesting reflections I had about crypto, I've been in crypto for probably 5 or 6 years now, and it's fascinating to reflect on how does crypto emerges from a underground phenomenon where mostly geeks and cryptographers and anarchists to become a global phenomenon that you can't, a topic that you can't avoid at dinner parties, especially in San Francisco or New York. And what have we learned is that how monetary economic incentives could really drive something from a underground thing to a global scale. Now, the interesting question is, could we apply the same market and incentive structure to accelerate things outside software? Yes, software is eating the world, but there are other hard problems in the world, such as space engineering, longevity, biotechnology, that are not really fully addressed by software. Can we have the same type of incentive to drive that? And that's the goal of this talk. I have been exploring for a majority of this year, talking to a variety of scientists in the biotech space, and there's some amazing developments that we could do that needs more awareness and funding. So here we go. And I also pick longevity, partly because anecdotally, I don't know if you guys know that, but Hal Finney, who is probably a Satoshi suspect, is actually frozen at Elcor Foundation. Does everyone know about Elcor Foundation? Elcor Foundation is a cryopreserve organization, been there for 30, 40 years. So essentially when your body is in a legally dead status, you basically got frozen there and hope that in the future, future science would revitalize your body, revive your body. So interesting anecdotes. Another connection between crypto and longevity is a guy named Ralph Merkle. Everyone knows about Merkle tree, right? Merkle signature. So Ralph Merkle is one of the founding fathers of modern cryptography. And apparently you don't hear about from Ralph these days about cryptography anymore because he's primarily working on life extension, in particular theoretical nanoscience at Singularity University. He's also on the board of Elcor Foundation and scientists. So that's an interesting anecdote. It's not surprising that a lot of my friends in the crypto space, they're actually either a member of Elcor Foundation or a person who's been fascinated about. And if you go back to the 1980s, the cypherpunk movement, there's an organization called the Extropians. And the Extropians has really two goals. If you read a lot of their internal publication, et cetera, one is no tax. And the second, no death. So when you think about these, so some of the no tax people basically are more towards the cryptocurrency anarchism stuff, and then you have the no death people working on life extension. So there's an interesting kind of link between the two worlds. So what exactly is longevity research in the biotech? How do we define that? Isn't curing diseases and attacking diseases all about the longevity anyway? So the way to define that is there's a very fundamental shift happening in the longevity or biotech industry, or biogerontology specifically, about how do we think about treating diseases or extending human life. The traditional paradigm is that we're going to focus on diseases, diabetes, cancers, Alzheimer's, et cetera. The new paradigm is that there's since the 2000, I would say, 1995 or 2000-ish, there's a group of pioneers in gerontology that say, instead of attacking diseases as they appear, we're going to focus on how we're going to reverse aging itself. Because if you look at this graph, everything is a function of age. The reason that someone who is 20 is extremely unlikely to get cancer versus when you get to 50 and 60, extremely likely to get cancer, is all driven by the common function of aging. And because of your molecular damage to your body and the various pre-programmed. There are different theories of aging, but fundamentally it's driven by age itself. So, and what we see is that as people focus on that angle, we see a number of really interesting interventions that are actually possible. For example, there's a famous mouse prize back in the, I think 2003, 2004, by Aubrey de Grey and David Gobo. So they published this prize, I think on MIT Technology Review, and talk about whoever can engineer the longest living mouse will win a prize of 25K or something. And then mouse, I think, extended actually to 2.5 times than a normal mouse. A normal mouse lives something like 2 years for that species. And in that their case, I think the latest record is 5 years through genetic engineering. There are other ways you could do that. You probably heard of fasting, right? A lot of people do intermittent fasting here in San Francisco. And fasting gives somewhere between 10-20% of increases on mouse. We don't know about for human specifically, but mouse has proven some improvements. We can engineer other things with genetic mutations, et cetera. One of my favorite, okay, this is actually the older one. One of my favorite example is a recent company called Osen Technology. They work on a category of technology called senolytics. What it means is that basically they clear up bad or zombie cells in your body. By clearing that up, they remove the negative signaling in your body and potentially extend your life. And so far, the experiment actually, as we speak, is still live right now. And the latest group of mice already live, I think, to 160 weeks, which is like 60% or 50% more than the control group of a normal mice. So we're talking about very, very significant life extension possible on mice. And that's to be tested on human, but I think it's extremely exciting developments here. So one of my favorite quotes used here, as people debate about what is a morality or ethical implication of living longer, that's one of my favorite quotes. There is no fundamental difference between saving lives and extending lives. When people say, should we, is it really moral to let people live a lot longer? I think the simple answer is, you know, it's if you have that technology or you have the potential for new technology and you don't extend them, it's really just killing people. It's as simple as that. That's an Aubrey de Grey quote from Sense Foundation. All right, so enough about the longevity. That's a kind of the context. It's one of the most exciting space I see in the technology right now. But there is a fundamental challenge of funding. And you'll be surprised to hear something as exciting as longevity has about less than $500 million per year of funding, depending on how you count it, probably a lot less actually, $100 million, $200 million scale. It has a mixed public impression. When you talk about life extension, people think about Blood Boy, Peter Thiel, right? All these bad associations with longevity. The truth is much more nuanced. You also have a lack of consistent goal, even among the academics. Like, how do I measure this drug? How do I know fasting really helps? All these kind of things. So how can we use market incentives, economic incentives, to kind of solve these problems? So here's an idea. Sorry, missed one slide. So traditional funding, if you look at a traditional current funding scale, channels, mostly are from public funding, the NSF, National Science Foundation, the DARPA, NIH, the National Institute of Health. There's some venture capital money, but the largest fund right now in this space is something like $30 to $40 million. We're talking about very, very small funding, especially if you compare about the insane level of funding in crypto, right? One of the good things about crypto is that we no longer have broke open source coders. All of the fund projects are pretty well funded. And then you have some funding coming from the big pharmas and calicos, which are quite limited. So the immediate answer as a crypto person, when you look at a funding problem, you would say, why wouldn't we just tokenize the science and research? Couldn't we just create tokens instead of a crypto software token? We create a tokenized security token, a IP. So this is a screenshot from IndieBio, which is one of the top, I guess, popular accelerator in the bio space. And you look at these description of these companies, and one of the problems you realize, it's really complicated to evaluate a technology. Like in 2017 and 2018, during the cryptomania, we've seen that people have no ability, most of people, to evaluate a proper white paper, how they are able to read about a stem cell paper or CRISPR paper. It's just really, really hard. So then you think about, okay, so we shouldn't let people to evaluate complicated techno papers and decide whether it's a scam, it's legit science, or just a highly risky bet. And science is extremely risky. We should let them bet on results instead. They should be just focusing on, if the science works, I want in, right? How do you do that? Here's a simple mechanism. How many people has heard of XPRIZE here? All right, cool. That's a cool audience. So most of you guys heard of it. So the XPRIZE just simply is a prize established in 1994, 95, I think, by Peter Diamandis, who's an entrepreneur. And he really obsessed about space, and he wanted to award people who can come up with a private aircraft vehicle to carry three people, right, to 100 kilometer altitude. And whoever does that get $10 million. Fun fact, when he announced the prize, he doesn't have the funding at all. What he did was a quite clever scheme. He went to insurance companies and say, can you guys insure the bet? Therefore, you're basically asking insurance company to bet against science progress within a limited time frame. And insurance company were stupid enough at the time to come up with a premium of $3.5 million. So we're talking about 1-to-3-ish ratio for that price. It turns out, I think 8 or 9 years later, a team in 2004, sponsored by Paul Allen, who really don't need more money, but really actually won the prize, right, for a private aircraft. And that's extremely exciting, and that incentivized about 30 teams around the 30 plus teams around the world to participate in this thing. So what we're really looking at is a mechanism that has a levered effect, right? We're talking about $10 million prize, but people probably spend $100 million plus from the 30 teams collectively that actually put in R&D budget, and it created global excitement, et cetera. So it's a fantastic mechanism. Now, there are a little bit of a limitation here. First of all, it's donation only. The reason it's called Ansari X Prize is because it was sponsored by an Iranian entrepreneur named Ansari, and she was one of the few sponsors who's willing to do that. So it's pretty hard to scale out to hundreds of millions or possibly billions of dollars level. It's also lack of public participation. The prize was mostly really just the public watching a group of lead scientists or engineers working on a problem. They don't really participate apart from observing. So can we do better in crypto market? I think we can. So here's an example of how do you do something for longevity. So imagine there's a prize, a longevity X prize, right? And the challenge is very objectively defined. It's not subjective. It's a most effective aging treatment that reversed by certain years of human bioage. And you would win, let's say, $25 million for funding. Now, crypto market is probably not very, my personal opinion, it wouldn't be very effective. It were pure donation. I think people want economic incentive that they get an upside. So instead, you would say the $25 million is an investment into the winning project. And so the token that you bought into, that longevity token, would represent an equity or IP in that winning team or winning teams, multiple teams. And there's some of the money left for grants. So the teams, for example, a group of, I don't know, Stanford teams and Harvard teams, et cetera, would get some initial grants if they have eligible technology and proof of concepts. Simple idea. How do you execute it? The first question we'd come up with is how do we measure even longevity? Are we gonna wait 30 years, 50 years before the test group die, right? So that's probably doesn't work out very well. So gladly, I spent some time with a guy named Steve Horvath at UCLA. He's a biostatistician, and he came up with this wonderful algorithm a couple of years ago and keep improving on it. It's something called a Horvath epigenetic clock. It takes a blood sample from you and measures the DNA methylation level of your body. And what that apparently shows, among numerous studies, has proven it has almost a 97 to 98% level of correlation with your chronological age, which is fantastic, right? So if you see a supercentenarian or self-claimed supercentenarian in the mountains and he's saying he's 120 years old, how do you know this guy's really 120 or not? There's really no way before that to test that. Apparently, Harvard clock give you that ability to prove that quite well. Now, that's not enough, though. What we really want to see is you give someone, let's say, a gene therapy, and you want to reverse a human bioage by 2 years. You want to measure pre and after. So measuring chronological age is not enough. We need to measure biological age, a bio clock. And his latest thing called Grim Clock, slightly scary, is actually predicts you very reasonably accurately your mortality, true mortality, and your health span, like basically living without disease thing. So it's wonderful. And what the implication is profound at both economic level and technology level. And what it means is that we can now test aging interventions, all kinds of aging interventions, fasting, gene therapy, rapamycin, metformin, et cetera, on a monthly scale, right? We can give someone a shot of something, of a cocktail of some kind of drug, and measure pre and post and after. And we can really observe that instead of waiting 5 or 10 years. The reason we were stuck with mice previously was primarily because it's impossible or way too costly for most human clinical trial. It takes like 10 years plus. So great. So we got the epigenetic clock, and now we can start defining the price. So imagine a token has a criteria something like this, right? Just illustration, but gives an idea. A grand prize for reversing human Horvath clock by 5 years versus a chronological age. So if you're 30 today or 40 today, if it reverses to 35, that's a successful experiment, right? We just measure pre and post and other bodily function, et cetera. And you got a $20 million grand prize for the investment. Second level, you could have $4 million innovator prize, you could have a POC prize, et cetera, et cetera. The point of having multiple prize is such that we can see continuous progress. You wouldn't be launching a prize and be just never hear from it after 5 years, between the 5 years. So you would have a continuum of progress on animal models, on primates, on mice, and et cetera. So that's XPRIZE. Now, how do you pitch that idea to a crowd? So here's this one way I think you would describe it from an investor perspective. What do you get as an investor? It's the way to think about it, it's a scientific moonshot ETF, right? There are moonshot projects today, like by Google and et cetera, NASA, but they're primarily sponsored by either private money or massive public money. There's not a single, I believe, way to for a crowd to bet on an ETF, which is a very clear scientific goal. So basically, the question it answers, how could I put money towards a science goal that I care about, whether it's lending to the moon, to Mars, or is it transplantable human organs, 3D printable human organs, et cetera, and get a reasonable return, right? I can donate money to these causes, but I can't get a reasonable return. You are stuck with a dilemma. Whereas if you compare it to a traditional regular VC fund, the question they answer is fairly boring, is which GP should I entrust for optimal financial return? That's fine, right? I mean, we all have need for financial, but it doesn't help that whether they are actually addressing the science mission that you care about. And I think that is a, XPRIZE is a way, crypto XPRIZE is a way to address that particular need. And also when VC fund evaluate deal, as many of you probably know, they look at various different factors. They look at pedigree, they look at team, they look at social proof, et cetera, et cetera. Not necessarily correlated with a science goal. So, moonshot ETF, and that obviously idea could be generalized to many different domains, not just longevity. It could be bioage reversal, it could be a personal flying machine, it could be replacing fossil fuels, climate change use, et cetera, et cetera. As long as the goal has a couple of criterias, they should be engineering and quantifiable, right? We don't want subjective goals. We want things that can be measured. That's why things like Horvath clock is so important. You want it to be ambitious and exciting. So the public actually wanted to this happen really badly. It's costly, but it's bounded costs. We're not talking about hundreds of million costs. We're talking about tens of millions of costs. Costs that could be potentially be sponsored, prepaid by the crowd. There is huge financial upside that if it were to succeed. And also, the most importantly, it has a diverse angle, meaning that when you crowdsource ideas, it should be that the problem itself is multifaceted. In the case of, for example, longevity, there are so many different ways to attack the problem. There are some very simple ways of lifestyle changes, of drinking less, of sleeping more, right? You get all these things all the way to super fancy stuff like analytics, gene therapy, and et cetera. So, as long as it meets these criteria, I think there's a very good chance that you could engineer something interesting with a crypto regular. Now, the other topic is what does the token price movement look like? It's not exactly an Ether token or a Bitcoin token where you talk about store values and medium exchange. This is not. This is clearly an investment-related token. How do you price it? So the way to think about this pricing is you could think of it implicitly risk-adjusted pricing, where it's essentially a science tracker, a science progress tracker. What it means that when you look at the price of longevity token, if it closed at $3.4, what exactly does that mean? It means basically your proxy over two things. One is how likely do you think that someone is going to solve the particular science challenge? What's the probability? And the second thing that answers is if it does get solved, what do you think is a potential enterprise value? In the case of longevity, we're talking about an addressable market of literally everyone, right? You probably don't have any other pitches that can address everyone, but this actually happens to everyone. So this is a huge addressable market, almost infinite. So the point is more about, it's actually a proxy about how likely do you think, how close you think we are in solving that problem. So it is essentially a prediction market in some way. In fact, you can construct, so I had some interesting conversation with Martin from Gnosis team. Some of you know it's a prediction market on Ethereum. And one of the interesting ideas that we brainstormed was an idea around a longevity index. The fact that you can continuously bet on the probability of a pure longevity index. Essentially, it's a derivative or a virtual derivative that settles every 6 or 12 months on the latest progress. So if it closes at $3.4, what it means is that by 20, at that point, the best technology could reverse human age at 3.4 years, for example. So there's ways to construct these interesting financial instruments that raises huge public awareness, right? You can imagine these longevity index traded or shown along as a ticker on a Bloomberg terminal, on a Bloomberg TV channel. So there's many interesting ways to make science ideas approachable to the mass as a financial market. Super exciting stuff. Now, there's one concern that we haven't talked about. It sounds like a security. So yes, you know, US has a lot of concerns around security, limited 1% of credit investors, et cetera. In this example, it's really interesting because you can separate out two types of interest in longevity. So the people who are just like me, who are just hobbyists and fascinated by longevity technology, who want to live longer for their family, et cetera, et cetera. And there's also the investment and speculation crowd. You can address them separately. So you can separate out the two tokens into two layers, a due token structure. The longevity token we just talked about is pure investment stuff, but it also contains a therapeutic. You can have a therapeutic branch, which basically have a therapy token. It's eligible for all buyers, right? It's a utility token. It's directly applicable to your future treatments. And the token can be used for staking in priority. So the more tokens you have, the higher you're in the queue for the treatment, which is fantastic, right? You basically have the early adopter paying for the later crowds. So that's about the X Prize. Now I want to shift gear a little bit, talk a little bit about a different problem. And how do we address using crypto primitives to solve a different class of not funding, but more data problems? So think about the human, so I'm calling this human biomarker atlas, right? And in general, biotech has this very traditional problem of proprietary data. Everyone wants proprietary data, because if you're a drug manufacturer, if you're R&D lab, you want as much proprietary stuff as possible. No one wants to share data. That's a hard problem. That's what 23andMe and et cetera are all basically trying to attack. And when we talk about data, there's really two important dimensions, or simple way to looking at it. There is a vertical dimension, which basically, for example, there's a recent initiative, very exciting one, called Human Cell Atlas, sponsored, I think, by Mark Zuckerberg, a Trans Zuckerberg initiative. They were trying to build an index, or human genome sequencing, of 37 type of trillion cells in your human body. That's more the vertical perspective. That needs massive amount of funding from a couple of centralized entities, not necessarily diversity. What we're interested here with crypto primitives is to address the population diversity. For example, how can we build the 100 million genome database that is kind of open or openly accessible for all researchers in the world? How can we build a epigenetics database or a proteomics or metabolomics database, et cetera? And that is more interesting for aging specifically because we want to look at the extreme end of the population. Why do certain people live longer? Why do people appear a lot younger than they actually are, and et cetera? How do you incentivize people to do that? There's obviously a huge need. So two examples I want to specifically to talk about, just give an idea what kind of data we're collecting. The first is from a biostatistician called Josh Middledorf. He's doing something called the N-of-1 epigenetic clinical trial. What you want to do is basically epigenetic, and in that case of Horvath clock that we just talked about, it's an epigenetic data. So goal, very simple, crowdsource all kinds of anyone's data, literally. Like, it doesn't matter how old you are, what kind of lifestyle you just submit your data. And all you have to do is basically submit a saliva or blood sample to a lab, and it costs roughly $200, right? And that's, and then attached with that sample, explain what kind of lifestyle, is it keto diet, are you on the Hoffman method, are you eating certain weird diet, are you on fasting, et cetera, et cetera. And based on that, we could have a collection of database of people of different lifestyle, and what is the implication to their bio clock. Simple example. Another example would be metabolomics, right? Metabolomics, by the way, just to explain it briefly, it is an intermediate product that is generated as part of your metabolism kind of cycle. So the point is, again, to crowdsource as much metabolic data as possible, and it's particularly targeting the aged and diseased population. How can we, when we collect enough data on metabolites, there's a good chance that we can predict Alzheimer's, we can predict diabetes way ahead before every other diagnosis possible. It's conducted by a researcher, Kevin Parrott, at Buck Institute of Aging. So both of the examples need some kind of incentive. There's a cost, right? There's a few hundred dollars of cost. Not too expensive, but not everyone necessarily wanted to pay that. There's also a lack of incentive. Why should I do that before it becomes useful to me? So here's a way you potentially you could construct it in the crypto DAO, which is a bit different from what we think about DAO traditionally. So first of all, one of the very, very nice things happening with next generation blockchains is they're trying to incorporate privacy as a first class citizen, right? So for example, in the case of Definity, that's one of the things we've been very, very interested in for a long time. There are some really interesting development there. So assume by 2019, most of the chains already have privacy. You can submit a transaction without revealing any of the private data, fantastic. Once you have that, it's possible or pretty straightforward to construct a state encrypted DAO, a DAO that does not have data public, expose data to the world. Why would you want to do that? The reason you want to do that is because in order to make something have an incentive, you have to accrue value in the DAO. If the DAO's primary value is in data, and yet somehow it is fully exposed to the public, that's not very useful, right? So we want an ability to show data when it wants to be. So imagine the state encrypted DAO can be done. And secondly, when data contributors contribute data, so if I want to measure my bio clock, so I submit a blood sample to a lab, and the lab then submitted data to the DAO, I would actually earn some tokens, maybe it was along with the lab as well, as an incentive. So I actually have a little bit of incentive to submit data sample apart from knowing my own bio clock, et cetera. And thirdly, if I still think that $250 is too expensive, the DAO actually could be a store value that it could subsidize third-party sampling. Which I think is fascinating. We essentially have a machine or a collective that actually can be crowdfunded, I don't know, $5, $10 million initial crowdfunding, can be paying for a number of people. It's just like a 23andMe saying that we're going to do free DNA sampling for now because, whatever, we raise VC funding and we want to subsidize, we're going to collect an amount of data. You can do the same thing, but with an open data collective, which is incredibly fascinating. And then, why does the DAO have value? Well, because a lot of research institutions and big pharma are willing to pay big money, and they could be paying, by the way, in stablecoin, so they don't have to suffer all the BTC and Ether kind of volatility stuff, to decrypt data, and they acquire a public license. And the public can say, okay, because there's a public license registry, and therefore we can enforce it in a crowd by saying, oh, do you have Pfizer? Have you acquired a license? So you basically have a crowd that's monitoring all these large institutions for user data. Have you paid a proper license for that? Did you steal that data, et cetera? So there are ways to directly monetize. And every time when a research institution pays money to the DAO, as the early investor or crowdfunder of that DAO, you actually can get paid. You are actually getting a dividend or some kind of a payout. So that's it's essentially a functioning as a replacement for a company. And the DAO, because it's a smart contract, you can guarantee that it will never become someone proprietary. It's never going to happen that Facebook suddenly decided, or 23andMe suddenly decided, we're not going to open the data to anyone. We're just going to sell to a huge pharma for $10 billion, and that's it, right? You would never have that kind of situation happen because of public DAO. Anyway, so that's my talk. So we really cover two really big things, right? One is a prize, a moonshot ETF, in this case, longevity prize, that can be used to raise funding and awareness, but also as a prediction market for progress of the science. And the second thing just covered is how do you construct a open business, a data collective that incentivizes people to contribute data. So. All right, that's my talk, and love collaborates on longevity. If you're interested from crypto background or from biology background or if you're from machine learning, et cetera. So thanks.